You can go over the theology as you are showing on the slides. So we can quickly go over point by point and see here is what Islam says and here is what the Ismailis are thinking and believing and practicing. So go ahead, Brother Akbar.
So, JazakAllah Khair, Brother Sabeel. What I did was I put together a few display elements, which I'm going to throw up on the screen. So I just want to go through the Ismaili theology. I just want to say, what's the Ismaili view of the Sharia? What's the true lineage of the Ismaili Imams? How do the Ismailis view the Quran, and what are the Ginans, which the Ismailis, which I just told you that, you know, in the religious center we had subjects, one of the subjects was Ginans. And then I just want to go through the five pillars, how the Ismailis view those five pillars, how the Muslims treat those five pillars, and how Ismailis treat those. First of all, the Ismaili theology. Now, First thing, I mean, heads up that, you know, many Ismailis, they don't even know this theology, because it's not taught in religious education centers unless you are doing, you know, your education from the London Ismaili Institute of Studies. Usually this stuff is not taught in the normal religious education centers. So many Ismailis who I've shown this to, they say, no, this is not what we believe. Where did you get this from? But this is from the Ismaili sources, right? Happy to share the sources of all of this, but this is what the Ismaili theology is.
Yes, so Brother Akbar, let me just again do a brief intro of this segment. So alhamdulillah, my name is Sabeel Ahmed. I'm here with Brother Akbar Khoja, who was brought up in an Ismaili background. His parents, his family, his khandan, they were from the Ismaili background. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him hidayah. He reverted or converted to Islam about 12 years ago. And now he's educating his fellow Ismailis and people of humanity about the truth of Islam compared to what the Ismailis, what they believe in. And alhamdulillah, he has a really important, vibrant, educative website, Rethinking Ismailism, right?
Yeah, rethinkingismailism.com and insidesmailism.net. Yeah.
MashaAllah. In this segment, inshallah, he's going to go over the important theological and practical aspects of Ismailism compared to what true Islam is. So go ahead, proceed, Brother Akbar.
JazakAllah Khair. So the first thing which is there in the Ismaili theology is that Ismailis believe that the world has a dwar, or the world has seven periods, right? So each of these periods has a natiq, and each natiq is accompanied by a wasi, right? So the first natiq, they say, was Adam. His wasi was Seth. That's one of his children, and then each door has seven imams. So there were seven imams in door number one, and what they say is that the seventh imam of a door would then get promoted and become the natiq of the second door, right?
So, before you proceed, if you can quickly translate the terms that you use. So those who may not speak either Arabic or Urdu, other languages, if you are able to translate them, that will really help us, inshallah.
Yeah, sure. So many of these terms, they are used, even if you look at English Ismaili sources, mm-hmm. They would just romanize the word dor, D-O-U-R, as is, and use that word. But in English, you can translate it as a period, right? Okay. So we can say that, you know, there are seven periods. Each period has a natiq. Natiq is, it's usually the prophets or somebody who is at the level of a prophet. Okay. And wasi is somebody who is accompanying him, right? So dor would be a period, natiq would be someone at the level of a prophet, the one who abrogates the rules which are set before him, right? So those are the loose translations which I would put forward.
Sure.
So So there was Adam, there was Seth, and then there were seven imams. And that repeats in each period, except for the seventh period. So the seventh period, they say, is unique, but the six periods would follow the same pattern. So Adam and Seth, and then Nuh or Noah and Shem, again, seven imams. The seventh imam would then get promoted to a natiq of the third door or the third period, Ibrahim alayhi salam or Abraham, and then Ismail alayhi salam, seven imams. The seventh imam would get promoted, and so on and so forth till the sixth period. Now, Ismailis believe that, Ismaili theology is actually what says that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a natiq of the sixth period. And guess who is what he is? It's Ali Karamullah Wajah, right? Ali alayhi salam. And then they say there are seven imams. So these seven imams, remember, Ismailis are called Shish Imamiya, because that's the theology. That's the basic theology which they follow, right? Even though they have up to the current imam, the current Aga Khan is the 49th imam. But the core of what they follow is here, right? It's Shish Imamiya. So that's where they are.
Where did they get this theology from? Is it obviously it's not coming from Quran or the Sunnah? Where do they extract this from?
They extract this from classical Fatimid period scholars such as primarily Abu Yaqub Sijistani. That's the person who came up with this, and it is said that he was also inspired by Hassan Sabah, and Hassan Sabah was also somebody who came up with this. The sources are between these Ismaili scholars, early Ismaili scholars. They were what I call the true Ismailis, right? The current period Ismailis, they associate themselves with those Fatimid era Ismailis. But when we talk about the lineage of the imams, you would know that the connection between the current period Nizari Ismailis and the Fatimid period Ismailis is not very clear cut. There are a lot of disconnections. But yeah, just to answer your question, this is where they get their theology from.
A really important educational point for our Ismaili brothers and sisters and the youth is that this is not coming from the Quran or from the Sunnah, the two primary sources of Islam. An opinion, a formulation of somebody who is far away after the time of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So important point that this is kind of made up by some person in history.
Yeah, absolutely. This has nothing to do with the Quran or the Hadith or anything. This is all just made up. So there were seven imams, right? So what happened that when Imam Jafar Sadiq was treated, was they called Imam Jafar Sadiq the imam as well, right? Mm-hmm. And Imam Jafar Sadiq is well respected within the Sunni and the Shia school, within all of Islam, right? So Imam Jafar Sadiq had a son called Ismail, right? And what happened actually was that Ismail, he died 5 years before Imam Jafar Sadiq passed away. So in Ismailism, in Ismaili theology, the imam has to be the eldest son of the imam. That's the norm. There might be a few exceptions here and there. It's difficult to find exceptions, but that's how the lineage goes. It's the eldest son of the next imam becomes the next imam. So with Imam Jafar Sadiq, his eldest son was Ismail. But what happened with Ismail was that he passed away. He died 5 years before Imam Jafar Sadiq. And this is recorded in, everywhere. This is even recorded in some Ismaili sources as well. And but this is where the split happened, right? And this is where the Isna'ashiriyah and the Ismailiyah, they broke off. The Ismailis, they said, even though he passed away, Ismail was the true imam, right? And then what they did was that they treated Muhammad bin Ismail, who was the son of Imam Ismail or Ismail, as the next legitimate imam. They said, you know, even though Ismail passed away, Imam Jafar Sadiq had appointed him as his successor. So, and by that, through that, Ismail's successor is his eldest son, which is Muhammad bin Ismail. So Muhammad bin Ismail was obviously very, very young when Ismail passed away, and Imam Jafar Sadiq was extremely, really old when Ismail passed away. But this is the split point of the Ismailis, that they treat Ismail as the imam, and the Isna'ashariya, they treat Musa Kazim as the imam.
So the word Ismaili or Ismailism comes from the word Ismail, who was a person way back, 1400 years ago.
Yeah. Quite a while back, son of Imam Jafar Sadiq, who, like I said, whoever, funnily enough, this is the only Ismaili imam who never actually performed his duties as an imam. He never saw his imamate come into fruition because he passed away. So his son, Muhammad bin Ismail, was taken as the imam. Now, what happened was that Muhammad bin Ismail, according to many historical records, he, because of the other group within the split, which is Isna'ashariya, he was either he vanished, right? Now, nobody knows. There are different accounts. Some people say he ran away. Some people say he was killed. Some people even deny his existence, right? So Muhammad bin Ismail, he vanished, right? And Ismailis, for several centuries after that, waited for him to come back, because what they believe, that you remember, he's number seven, right? So number seven is supposed to become elevated and become the next period's natiq, right? So that's where, you know, Ismailis, centuries after Muhammad bin Ismail, were waiting for the next imam to announce that, you know, that yes, I am the natiq. But that never happened. And a few centuries after Muhammad bin Ismail went away, the Ismaili, the Fatimid dynasty was established. And even at that time, none of the imams had come forward and said that, you know, I'm the natiq. The Ismaili theology, which Hassan bin Sabah had promoted, was that is that a time will come, that an imam will come, who will actually be this imam, who will actually be Muhammad bin Ismail, and he will announce that he is the natiq of period number seven, and period number seven is actually the qiyamah, actually. So the seventh. So when Muhammad Ismail would come into, reappear, he would reappear as not only the natiq of period number seven, he would actually be the Mahdi. So just like the Muslim, even the Shia, right? They know that Imam Mahdi is gonna come, and the Sunni school believes that, you know, Imam Mahdi and Isa alayhi salam, at the near of the end of times will reappear. The Ismaili theology says that that when Muhammad bin Ismail would reappear, he would reappear as the Mahdi. The Mahdi would declare the Qiyamah, and the Qiyamah would mean that all the Shari'i ritual practices will be abolished, right? So that never happened. That never happened. Centuries went by. The Ismaili imams. I would go to one of my later slides. So this is what happened. So you see Imam Ismail, which I've highlighted here, right? And then the Ismaili imamate continued, right? One way or the other, there was a hidden period. There was a Daura Satr, which Ismaili says was a hidden period, and I've numbered it down to number 49, which is the current Aga Khan, which is Aga Khan the fourth, Karim Al Husseini. But this is where this is what happened in this Imam, right? This person, whose name is Hassan Ala Zikri Salam. There are different accounts which also say that even Ismaili's book, they acknowledge that Hassan, his actual name was Hassan, but he's known by Ismailis as Imam Allah Zikr Salam. Allah Zikr Salam, he was not the son of the previous Imam. He was not the biological son of the previous Imams. There are Ismaili books, and there are Ismaili records, even the primary Ismaili historical records, such as Farhad Daftari's book, Ismailis, their doctrines and their principles. It acknowledges that Hasan Allah Zikr Salam was not the biological son of the previous Imam. So this person, the Imam number 23, he was heavily inspired by the Ismaili theology, which we just saw. He knew that, you know, Ismailis are waiting for a Mahdi. Ismailis are waiting for the Qayyim al-Qiyama, as they call him, the person who will declare the Qiyama. And he rose up. He stood up on the minbar one fine day, and that was during Ramadan, right? And he said that the Imam of the time has sent me. And he later on he claimed to be the Imam himself. But at that time he said, the Imam of the time has sent me to abolish all Shara'i burdens from you, and I'm declaring and has declared today as the Qiyama. And from today you will have no burden of Shara'i principles. So that was the middle of Ramadan when he was saying that. That was in the middle of a fast, right? And after this announcement, he made all the Ismailis break their fast. It is said that it's written in numerous historical records, including The Assassins by Bernard Lewis. He made all the Ismailis break their fast with wine in the middle of the day. And from that period onwards, Ismailis have stopped practicing all Shari'i principles and rules, including fasting and praying and anything to that effect. And there is a recent presentation which happened, done by a Ismaili. He calls himself a scholar, but here are a few slides from that presentation. And that's what he said. It's not, so this is not something which I'm claiming. It's something which the Ismaili scholar has clearly presented in one of his presentations, that the Sharia stood abrogated from the time of the 23rd Imam, which I just showed on the screen, Imam Allah Zikr Salam. And Ismailis take this time as the completion of the prophecy of the reappearance of the seventh Imam, who would be the Mahdi and who would declare the Qiyama. Let me show you these four slides from up close. So this is a screen capture from his Zoom presentation. You can see him up there. And he writes clearly that following the Nizari Musta'ali Schism, which is a split, the 23rd Imam, Imam Allah Zikr Salam, convened a special gathering in Alamout in Persia, in which he declared the Qiyama on the 17th day of Ramadan and had a banquet feast. And he's quoting those exact words. He's saying, the Imam of the times has sent you his blessings and compassion. He has called you his special chosen servants, has relieved you of the duties and the burdens of the Sharia, and brought to you the Qiyama, or the resurrection. And resurrection is something, you know, you just search it on the internet, resurrection in Ismailism, and you would get various historical sources on which there is enough documentation. Qiyama, he says, entailed the abrogation of Shari'i rituals and principles, elevation of worship. Now, this is how they put it. They say, we have elevated the worship to a higher spiritual interior level, the hakiki pillars of Islam. So they say that, you know, normal Muslims, they practice the Shari'i principles of, or Shari'i pillars of Islam. We Ismailis have elevated worship to a higher spiritual level, and those are the hakiki pillars of Islam. And then he's saying that Ismailis have now started focusing, and from actually saying that from that time Ismailis focus on recognizing the truth or the haqiqah through the manifestation in the Imam. And this is a quote from one of their scholars, Nasiruddin Tusi, who writes in the Paradise of Submission that the age of religious law, Zamana Shariat, is the time in which worship or ibadah is ordained at specific times. when the practice of external physical behavior is dictated, and when acts of worship are completely absorbed in their specific temporal moments, which is what Muslims do, right? We do ibadah at specific time, it's physical behavior and so forth. He said this age is called the cycle of concealment, Dara Sadr being particular characteristic of the prophets. On the other hand, now he's saying what the Ismailis do. On the other hand, the age of Qiyamah or the Qiyamah is when specific times of worship are abrogated. So he's saying that we Ismailis, we don't do worship like you Muslims do in specific times of worship. When people are summoned onto God for his own sake and when all moments of life are completely absorbed in the practice of devotion. He said, we Ismailis, for us, all the moments of life are completely absorbed in the practice of devotion. So he's saying that Muslims are at a lower level because they pray like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam did, right? And indirectly, he's saying that the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam did was at a lower level. And just to give it a fancy label, he says, you know, that was like the cycle of concealment, you see, mm-hmm. in the line just above the underlined lines. It says, you know, that age was the cycle of concealment, Dara Satr, when the prophets were just doing these apparent acts of worship. Now we are doing real worship. All moments of our lives are completely absorbed in the practice of devotion.
Yeah, you know, three important observations comes to mind. One is just a shock, just listening to this and looking at the evidence. It's just shocking. I mean, how can somebody? Second thing would be, how can anyone abrogate the Sharia that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given? You know, I mean, that person is not a prophet. I mean, Allah is the one who gave the Sharia. No one can abrogate it. Third important point and observation is, and they're blindly following without questioning. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a mind, a brain to think and ponder. And these are the harms of just blindly following someone, devoid of the Quran and the Sunnah and the Sharia. So it's an important wake-up call for the Muslims and for all of us that we should ask questions. We should have a frame of reference. If that goes away, then anything that happens, and unfortunately, we are looking at it. May Allah protect all of us from that kind of a deviation.
Ameen. Jazakallah khair, Brother Sabeel. Just a couple of more slides on this. So just to show what do they now see as the true, as they say, pillars of Islam. So same slide, but at the bottom you see that the true or haqiqi salah is not what Muslims do, but it's actually the perpetual state of prayer by remembering God and obeying the Imam. So obeying the Imam and remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they say it's a perpetual state of prayer, not like the five times prayer which Muslims do. What about fasting? They say that true haqiqi fasting is surrendering all of your faculties to the command of God for the entire year. That is fasting, not like staying hungry from dawn to dusk, as the Quran says, as the Prophet ﷺ did, as even Ali radiallahu anh did, right? They say, no, that is not haqiqi fasting. That was like they were going through the cycle of concealment. So now the true
do they pray five times a day in their jamatkhana, right?
No, absolutely not. They've replaced the Muslim salah with a different prayer, right? So if you go and ask them that, hey, do you pray like salah or do you pray namaz, right? Mm-hmm. They would say, yeah, absolutely, we do. But what they don't tell you is that this prayer is completely different. It's like you asking a Hindu saying, if you ask a Hindu saying, ask him that, do you worship your God? And he would say, yes. But his worship and the Muslim worship are completely different. Similarly, the Ismaili prayer and the Muslim prayer are completely different. I'll tell you more about the Ismaili prayer a little bit when we get to the five pillars. Yeah, inshallah. And zakah, what about the zakah? Zakah is actually donating one's resources and knowledge to other believers. That's the classical Ismaili belief, that donation of knowledge and resources to other believers is true zakah. Now, funnily enough, in the present day and age, the Aga Khan, he does not follow this one. So when it comes to, I mean, this is really, really hilarious because when it comes to the Bathini interpretation, the Ismaili Imam, unfortunately, have to pinpoint, but the Ismaili Imam has a Bathini interpretation for everything. For Salah, it's a Bathini interpretation, which is, you know, remembering God. For fast, it's a Bathini interpretation. For Hajj, there's a Bathini interpretation. For Jihad, there's a Bathini interpretation. But when it comes to Zakah, you know, here it says donate one's knowledge and resource and knowledge. Now I give that Aga Khan does have an initiative called TKN, it's Time, Knowledge, and Nazarana, which Ismailis do give their time and knowledge and resources. But it doesn't absolve them of paying money to the Imam. So the Ismailis, they still pay. There's no esoteric interpretation for Zakah. They still pay, real money to the Imam, and which is at a much, much, much higher rate than the Zakah. The Zakah is just 2.5% of your excess mm-hmm. wealth for the entire year. Ismailis are made to pay 10 to 12%, 12.5% of their monthly income before expenses. So if I earn $10,000 a month, you know, I pay 12.5% straight out of that, even before incurring any expenses. Whereas Islam, you earn that for the entire year, you consume it, and whatever is left over and left untouched for a year, then you pay zakah on it. But in Ismailism, you know, the classical Ismaili scholars say that zakat is donation of time and resources. But today, we know money is still there. There's no esoteric money which is accepted at the jamatkhana. It has to be real money.
So what happens, like, suppose if a Ismaili goes to the jamatkhana and they don't have money, they are poor, can they go pray, do all things, or would they be looked down, look upon? I mean, what happens?
Honestly speaking, they can go, okay. but it's considered very, very strange if a Ismaili goes to the jamatkhana and doesn't go and put something in the bowl or put something in the box, because it's a normal practice. You know, for example, when you go to the jamatkhana, even if you go before prayer, there's a lineup for paying money, or what they call mehmani, right? If you're not doing that, you know, you would do that after the prayer. But if somebody were to observe you that you're not doing that either before the prayer or even after the prayer, then you would be looked at suspiciously. You know, you would be kind of looked at somebody who's not willing to pay. Well, why are you not paying to the Imam, right? Why don't you pay up? So it's like I said, it you know, people can do that, but nobody does that. You know, nobody does that.
So it's like a ticket to go inside and pray in one way. People expect it. Yeah. People are looking for it. If you don't pay, they are looking at you. What is this guy doing?
Yeah. But you know, to be fair, they don't ask for it, but it's very awkward not to do it.
I see.
Yeah. Back in the day, they used to go around with a bowl all around the rows, you know, and everybody has to put in something in there. But nowadays, what they've done is that they've put those bowls in the side. Maybe it was due to the recent COVID situation. They ended up closing the Jamaat Khanas as well, and now they're opening up. They've opened up in North America, not so in the other parts of the world. But recently, I've noticed that they've started putting those collection bowls in the corner. But they're there. They're not going anywhere. It's not like, oh, we're not collecting anymore.
Yes, yeah, it's still there. For them, I guess. You know, just by looking at the slide and the bottom part of the slide, you know, true, haqiqi, salat, and fasting, zakat, hajj, jihad, I'm thinking, you know, this is not Islam. I mean, Islam is here, and this is like something made up by people. And they are just giving some Arabic terminology, Islamic terminology, Quran, Sunnah out of context. They made up their own religion. I mean, this is not Islam, though. I mean, even my you know, a seven-year-old can look at it. If I ask him, what are the five pillars, how do we do it? He would know it. But this is not coming from the Quran and the Sunnah. Wake up call for the Ismailis, that we need to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Truth matters more to us than anything else.
Yeah. I mean, as you said, that they're using Islamic labels, right? But it's definitely not Islam. Giving something an Arabic name doesn't, or reusing a Muslim term and putting it on your act of worship or method of worship doesn't really make it Islam. I mean, if a Hindu were to say that, you know, if he would go to his mandir and do his puja and say that I just prayed my salah, this is equivalent to that. You know, this is
one more important point I want to share over here. December is almost here, and we go outside, we see all of these Christmas decorations, and I'm from Chicago. So when we go outside, we see the Christmas trees, the Christmas decoration in the malls, in front of the houses, and it almost makes me always fearful for the Muslim Ummah, is that the original followers of Prophet Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, they were Muslims, but later on, followers after followers, they started to deviate away from the Injil and from the main message of Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, the message of worshiping the one creator, not worshiping him or Trinity or Holy Spirit, just worshiping the creator. As they deviated from the true Islam, now they formed a new faith called Christianity. And that deviation happened because they lost the frame of reference. When we look into this, you know, deviations that Ismailis have away from the salah, the fasting, zakat, hajj, jihad, important for us to always make sure that our actions, our beliefs should align with the Quran and the authentic sunnah of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Or else may Allah protect us. Our progeny may move away, and then we may be thinking why? Because the frame of reference was diluted. So may Allah bring these Ismailis back to the true Islam and protect the Muslim Ummah and educate the non-Muslims about what Islam is and what Islam is not, and give them hidayah so they can embrace Islam, inshallah.
Inshallah, jazakallah khair. Those are very, very deep thoughts, Brother Sabeel. We appreciate that. So moving on to different sources which do document this event of the resurrection or the qiyamah. There's another book called The Mystical Islamic Essence of the Sacred Art of Alchemy by Eberle, John Eberle, and he wrote that Hassan on this day effectively broke the chains of Islamic law by ordering all to break their fasts with food and wine, the latter a substance explicitly forbidden by the Quran for consumption at any time. And there are even books who go on to claim that, you know, even mothers and sisters were made halal for the men. Yeah, I mean, weird stuff, but this the stuff to this extent is obviously clearly documented in these and various other sources.
So, Akbar, if you go back to not the previous slide, to the previous slide, one more slide back. Yeah, you know, when this 23rd Imam, and he mentioned that Qiyamah is here now, right?
Yeah.
I mean, how would they justify that we are not there? I mean, Qiyamah means all of these things should happen. Antichrist and, you know, earthquakes and people gathered together and the Day of Judgment, all of those. I mean, how would they reconcile that these things did not happen, but they're saying they happened? Where is the connecting point?
No, it's there's not. They are very, very distant from the Quran, right? When the Quran, you know, speaks clearly of the day of Qiyamah, right? You could hear these Ismaili missionaries and these professors and whatever they call themselves. They would go to the Quran and twist the meanings and say that, you know, this doesn't really mention that. For example, the other day I was hearing something about Laylatul Qadr, right? And the verses were being mistranslated, right? Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr, and this one of these Ismaili duat was saying that inna anzalnahu, we revealed that. Who is like that, right? In Arabic. So he went on to explain that, you know, inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr, the explanation of we revealed the Quran on Laylatul Qadr, the Quran doesn't really say that the Quran was revealed on Laylatul Qadr. It just says, inna anzalnahu. So who could be, you know, so many things, and actually it's the imam, and then this and that. So, you know, this is how they would go on and twist the meaning. So can you imagine that something as simple as, you know, inna anzalnahu fi laylatul qadr, was twisted and made out to be, you know, not the Quran, but actually the imam, or something to that effect. I mean, it was very, very sad to hear that. And Ismailis, I mean, if Ismailis is actually an academic, or I would say a student of knowledge in Ismaili terms, he would listen to these scholars and read books such as, you know, The Paradise of Submission. And there are some other books which talk about, you know, esoteric stuff. You know, esotericism is, to me, it's a disease, right? And it exists, even in Christianity, it exists. There's an esoteric sect of Christianity. And mainstream Christians, they say, you know, we have absolutely nothing to do with these guys. They don't know what they're saying. You know, it's inspired by Greek mythology and so forth. And the same thing is with all of this, right? You would see elements of also Greek mysticism and other elements cooking together and then coming out with all of this stuff.
Just by looking at the slide again, that anytime if there is a disagreement, if a XYZ imam or any Muslim is saying, you know what, this is the interpretation of this Quranic ayah, always it's important for me and you and the Muslims and even the Ismaili brothers and sisters in humanity, anyone, to find out that what was the original interpretation of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, on that ayah of the Quran, that surah or that segment of the Quran. How did the noble companions of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, what was their take, their interpretation of that Quranic ayah? If this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to believe about that interpretation of that ayah, we need to align our interpretation with that. And we should be always aware, you know, if somebody is saying some other deviant interpretation, then we can see, you know what, this is what the Prophet believed, this is what this person is saying, then we are cautious. That will be like the frame of reference for us, what the Prophet said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So absolutely, no matter, I mean, looks like they are taking any word of the Quran and having any spin on it.
Yeah, absolutely. That's how it is. That's how it is.
Every slide or every main concept that you're mentioning.
Yeah, it's shocking.
Point, there is a dawah point, there is a shocking point, and we need to raise it just to educate ourselves and protect ourselves from the fitna, from the deviation, and to educate those listeners who may be, alhamdulillah, sincere people just coming to the video and looking at the conversation, and they want to now decide, what should they believe? And this will help them, inshallah, if you extract those points from this wonderful slides that you have. Alhamdulillah.
So after this, what happened was that this Ismaili scholar making the presentation, he says that one of the books which is attributed to one of the Ismaili imams, his name is Imam Shah Gharib Mirza. Again, this book is attributed to him, but there's no concrete you know, surety that he was the one who wrote it, but this is what he also writes. He says that the fasting of the tongue, so he elaborates on what fasting, true fasting is, right? And in Peer Pandiyat Jawamardi, he writes that the fasting of the tongue means that one should keep his tongue away from uttering abuse and slander. Fasting of the heart means to keep the heart free from doubt. Fasting of the foot is to hold one foot back from a wrong step. Fasting of the hand is to keep all one's limbs away from treachery so that they may not do evil. And this especially applies to one's tongue, which must be kept from uttering lies. And there's no greater lie than the denial of the imam saying that he has disappeared, right? So they wanted to make sure that, you know, Ismailis, they don't think the imam has disappeared. The imam is there. Because there were several, they would call it conspiracy theories, that the Ismailis believed that the imam had gone into hiding. The imam is not communicating; he's just communicating through his peers and his representatives. So one of the things which this guy came out and wrote is that there's no greater lie than the denial of the imam or saying that he has disappeared. So this is how, you know, the fasting has been has been portrayed in Ismailism ever since that time. Now, what happened recently? This is important. I'll go over this quickly because we spent quite some time on the Qiyamah. Was that when the recent Ismaili Imam, his name was Sultan Muhammad Shah, and he's pretty well known because he was close to the founder of Pakistan, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, and Jinnah actually famously called him to Islam. So Jinnah told him that, you know, you should leave leading this sect called Ismailism and come to Islam. You know, that was pretty courageous of Jinnah to do. But what happened was that when Sultan Muhammad Shah came and claimed lineage to the Fatimids, because remember, many historians write that when this person came on to the world stage and during the time of the British, and you know, the British, they propped up many, many individuals. They even promoted sectarianism within Islam. Many religious institutions were founded and registered, and, you know, institutions were built during the time of the British. Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Qadiani was promoted at the time of the British. And the Aga Khans, especially the first, the one on the screen is the third Aga Khan, but the first Aga Khan also played a major role in helping the British conquering different Afghan places in Afghan region and also the Sindh province. He had his people fighting for the British, and this person, the third Aga Khan, he then claimed lineage to the Fatimids, and then a book was written called Nur-e-Mubin. And Nur-e-Mubin was a history book. It's an 800-900 page history book, which was written to connect the current imams, the current Aga Khans, to the Fatimid imams, and who were actually destroyed by the Mongols. So after the Mongols were there in the Fatimid era, and they completely destroyed not only the Fatimid dynasty, they killed everybody. You know, they would not even, it's famous, wherever the Mongols go, nobody breathes, right? Except them, right? They kill and wipe off everything off the face of the earth. So this guy comes onto the world stage and claims lineage to those Fatimid imams. And what he observes is that even in the present day and age, he saw that some communities in Iran and Syria were still observing Shari'i ritual practices, including Ramadan fasting. So what he did was that he sent them a special message addressed to those people in Iran and Syria, and he told them that you don't need to observe these rituals. He told them that namaz, Ramadan fasting, Hajj to Mecca, even facing Mecca in prayer and ritual obligation, he told them that, guys, these are abrogated. It's no longer mandatory for you believers to perform them. And he made sure that all of them were abolished. He even made sure that the hijab was abolished. And he actually proudly made a mention of that in one of the All India Muslim League conference speeches, which he made. He said that, I've made sure that none of my people, none of my followers, they observe the parda. That is something from the Stone Age. And he said that publicly. And obviously there was nobody to question him because he was, you know, being protected and, you know, put forward by the British, right? So then he told them that, you know, the other practices which you did, which is dua, dhikr, and tasbih, they are now congregational practice. And now you need to observe the dua in public. Dua, it is actually the word for the Ismaili prayer. He said, now they are public. And there's a Howard PhD thesis by Dr. Rafiq Kishavji, and the quest for gnosis and the call of history, modernization among the Ismailis of Iran. He mentions these three points it's quoted at the bottom in blue, but he wrote that the Iranian Ismailis, they ceased praying namaz and instead recited a Persian dua. And the secret prayer sessions such as dhikr, wird, and qasida became jamaati practices. And the Ismailis discontinued ritual ablutions, which is the wudu, hajj to Makkah, and fasting Ramadan. So his exact words were, they were not to observe the fast of Ramadan because the true fast was abstention all year from evil. The holy war, which is jihad, was no longer to be fought literally because the greater was within, against the nafs, the lower self. And finally, all the recommendations, prescriptions, and proscriptions to be followed were to be those issuing directly from the imam. So that's what he wrote. And you know, brother Sabeel, this is something you would find common in that day, right? Sultan Muhammad Shah, he instructed Ismailis not to fight literally against their masters. You would know that Ghulam Qadiani, right, Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, he did the exact same thing, didn't he?
I was going to say the same thing. Yes. Yeah,
because the British were bitten bad in the 1957 War of Independence, right? They didn't want that to happen again. No way. And they wanted to, and all of these elements, they were Mirza Ghulam Ahmad and Aga Khan and so forth. They were pushed forward with this agenda, especially after that War of Independence in 1857.
Yeah, no, alhamdulillah, that's a good overview.
Yeah, I have a couple of more slides on the Ta'wil of Sharia.
Yes,
so
yes,
presently correct. What the Ismailis practice is that for them, zakat is is paying 12.5% of monthly income to the imam. Some Ismailis, they pay more. They pay up to 25%. The Khoja Ismailis, the Ismailis from India and Pakistan, they pay 12.5%. Even in Africa and who also live in Northern America, they pay 12.5%. Some Ismailis who there's a small schism within Ismailis. So some Ismailis, especially in the northern parts of Pakistan, they pay 10%, but it can go up to 25%. Hajj for them is just looking at the imam. You look at the imam and you see a picture on the left side. The esoteric hajj to the living house of God. This is not something which I wrote, and this is something which has come from a Ismaili website. This is what they write in the esoteric hajj to the living house of God. So they call the imam the living house of God. Na'udhubillah. Salah is now replaced with a completely different prayer, which we'll touch upon when we look at the five pillars in detail. Psalm, like they say, is an internal fast of taming the nafs. Food is often served in jamatkhanas during Ramadan fast. Fasting happens on occasions other than Ramadan for 3 to 4 days a year. They call it Shukarwari Beach. So Ismailis, they do fast, but they only fast 3 to 4 days in a year. They call it Shukarwari Beach. They have different names. They have something called Satima Ka Roza, and it had Hindu origins. So the Ismailis now renamed it to Mola Shaka Roza. And Tawheed for them is something shocking. The Imam, he has actually called himself the Mazhar of Allah. You would see Ismaili, da'is and missionaries, trying to protect the word Mazhar. But Mazhar is something, you know, just like a mat'am is a place where you eat food, where you eat your ta'am, right? And masjid is a place where you make your sujood. Similarly, mazhar is a word, is a place where zuhur happens, right? So it's a place where Allah manifests himself. So imam is the mazhar of God, they say. So
manifestation means, is it similar to what the Christians believe about Isa alayhi salam, God incarnated, or the Hindus have the same similar concept?
Yes, yeah, very similar. So I've heard one of these Ismaili missionaries, he's saying that, you know, it's just like a reflection in the mirror, manifestation, a mazhar of God. When the imam, we say imam is a mazhar of God, it's just like, you know, the mirror image of God, but it's not God. That's a disclaimer which he says. He says it's not God, because if you're looking at them at your image in the mirror, is it you? Is that you? That's not you. That's your mirror. That's your image. So we can't say Imam is God, but he's the mother of God. So you know, they like I told you, right? They put these spin on things. They try to say that it's this, but it's not this, right? But that's how it is. And this is at the bottom again. I think it's from Muhyidd al-Shirazi. Yeah. So from his Diwan, he says, and that's the English translation of it. He says that, O most glorious Qibla of truth. Now this is addressed to the Imam, right? O most glorious Qibla of the truth and most sublime Kaaba of the living. If the Hajj is undertaken to an inanimate house in Makkah, so much more fitting, so much more worthy that we betake ourselves unto you. So that's how they look at their Imam. Also about the second abrogation. This is one quote by the Ismaili Imam on the right side, which I wanted to bring our viewers' attention to, was that he said that our social...
Yeah. They keep on abrogating Sharia. I mean, why do they have to abrogate so many times?
There is a deeper discussion on this. I wanted to keep this at a high level, but I'll just quickly to tell you one thing, is that between the first and the second abrogation, there are a lot of things which happen. So there's one Ismaili Imam. I'll give out his name to you. It's clearly documented in various sources that he actually embraced Islam. He became Muslim. He became Sunni Muslim. He actually publicly he publicly said that Hassan bin Sabah was wrong. His theology was wrong. His thought was wrong, and he embraced Islam. Right. So that's one thing which happened. The other thing which happened was that the Shari'i abrogation, when it was instituted by the 23rd Imam, who we spoke of, Hassan al-Azikr al-Salam, that was not the day of communication, right? So some Ismaili communities, actually, they continued practicing Shari'i rituals. They heard the rumor that there was abolition of Sharia, but they didn't believe it, right? So the Egypt and the Ismaili Jamaats in Egypt and Syria were disconnected. They weren't really on the same page. So there were elements of and also what happened is that some subsequent imams, they reinstituted the Sharia. They said that the Shari'i abrogation, which Imam Al-Azikr Salam did, was invalid, and they said that we are reinstituting the Sharia. And then, you know, a period came when Ismailis were destroyed by the Mongols, right? But when Imam Sultan Muhammad Shah came, the third Aga Khan, he connected his lineage to those Fatimids who had declared Qiyamah. So he had to underline that. So he came, and that's why he came and did the second abrogation, which I'm calling it here.
So
see what I mean?
So some imams believe Qiyamah came, some did not, and they flipped back to reinstating the Sharia for a brief time maybe.
Yeah, the thing is that there was the Ismailis at that time, at the time of Imam Al-Azikr al-Salam, right? Or Hassan, his name was. There was a small cult within the Fatimid dynasty who was following Hassan bin Sabah's teachings. There was a small sect who believed in this Qiyamah, and that Muhammad bin Ismail will come again. He will become the Qaim al-Qiyamah. There was a very small sect which believed this. The other Ismailis were, you know, they were normal Muslims, right? They had some other beliefs. They said that, you know, Imamah was there and so forth. But as far as practicing Islam was concerned, they didn't have these strange and these heretic beliefs which Hassan bin Sabah had. What happened was that Hassan al-Azikr al-Salam, he fell into the hands of that cult. So when he became Imam, or when he got his chance to come on stage and declare to be the messenger from the Imam, and then claim to be the Imam himself, he was actually impacted by the cult. And this gives us a very, very big message that, you know, change is always, whosoever is controlling the reins, you know, that he controls whatever happens in his dominion, right? So even though many Ismailis did not share the same thought of Hassan bin Sabah, but when Hassan al-Azikr al-Salam came and he promoted Hassan Sabah's thought from his position of power, it trickled down. It had an effect, right? It had an effect on all the Ismailis who were there at that time. But when he went away, when he died, a few generation afterwards, right, the Ismaili Imams, they went back on this. And it's also written in history books that they did this to make sure that they reestablish their connections with the Muslim Khilafas, right? The Abbasids, the Ayyubids, and so forth.
That can be
they
the
wanted
reason.
To reestablish their relationships.
Yeah, that can be the reason. You know, just like in the British India or Pakistan, the Ismailis, they changed the position of jihad to just, you know, fighting within self. Maybe the same thing happened when the Muslims were strong and the Ismailis, they wanted to just appease the Muslims and they reinstated the Sharia perhaps.
Yeah. That's very well documented. That, you know, that was the reason. That's very well documented. And this was the second abrogation is also documented. I just wanted to show this to make a point that it's not something which Akbar Khoja is claiming. This book by Peter Clark, New Trends and Developments in the World of Islam, says clearly that changes were introduced in the areas of ritual. In Syria, a new Mukhi, which is the head of the Jama'ah, appointed by Aga Khanis in 1895, was instructed in Khoja doctrines and rituals and told to introduce them into Syria. So whatever were the Indian practices, they were exported to Syria. Similar changes were introduced in Iran. Hajj and fasting were abandoned along with ritual ablutions before prayers. God rather than his house was to be worshipped. And, you know, in Ismailism, who's God? True fast was year-round absentation from evil. True ablution was cleansing of the heart. Duties, ibadah, regarded as essential by other Muslims, such as Hajj and fasting, were defined as furu. Or auxiliaries of the faith, you know. They're not the core of the faith, he said. They are the furu of the deen. And like I said, this is documented by Peter Clark in his book. Some references from modern history and modern history of the Ismailis, new trends and developments in the world of Islam, some references for people to verify what I'm saying, which are displayed on the screen right now.
Okay, mashallah.
This is again a farman, which I'm not going to read out, but is an imam from, it's a farman from the third Agha, Sultan Muhammad Shah. It's written in Kalam Imam Mubin. He says that, you know, fasting is not for 360 days a year. The world is only for 2 days. You know, think of becoming pure through the ibadah and so forth. So again, this is where he's downplaying the importance of fasting. And again, this is displayed, this was presented by the Ismaili scholar who you're seeing on the screen right now. That's how he's defining fasting. It's never to lie, never to cheat, never to slander. And the book reference is right under there for anybody to check.
If you go back to the previous slide, something interested me. The second line is that it says it is necessary to practice taqiyya so that others do not criticize. What does that mean?
Yeah, it means that a couple of days back, I was talking to a Ismaili, and I told him that, you know, it was about the importance or about the stature of Imam in Islam. And I told him that nobody, you know, denies the requirement of a Imam or a Sultan or a leader. You know, we all agree that, you know, we all need a whether it's you call it Imam, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Sultan, Khalifa, whatever, right? We all need a leader. That's agreed. But nowhere does a leader or the Imam has the authority to abrogate what's in the Quran. He said, yeah, our Imam doesn't abrogate the Quran. He just does that. And I told him, no, your Imam does. And I asked him, does the Quran ask you to perform ruku'? And he said, yeah, absolutely does. And I asked him, do you Ismailis when you pray in your Ismaili prayer, do you perform ruku? And he said, yes, we do perform ruku. And I told him that, please don't lie. You know, I am an ex-Ismaili. I know that the Ismaili prayer is devoid of any ruku. We don't do ruku. Don't lie. And that's an example of taqiyya, right? They hide. They don't speak about their beliefs in the open. You would ask them that, do you pray? And they would say, yeah, we pray. And you would ask them, do you fast? And they would say, yeah, we fast. And do you go for Hajj? They would say, yeah, we go for Hajj. But for them, the Hajj is looking at the Imam. For them, fasting is, you know, this is what fasting is, which is on the screen right now. Never to lie, never to cheat. Yeah. So that's what taqiyya is.
How can they reconcile that to perform taqiyya? And then point number one, never to lie. I mean, they can't adequately... Just looking at it, right?
Allah bless you. That's that's a very, very good point. Never to lie, but at the same time, from taqiyya.
It is necessary. Okay. Alhamdulillah, may Allah give them hidayah, you know, what can we say, and keep us guided.
Summa, ameen. I have a last slide. This is a farman of the previous Aga Khan dated 4 December 1952. He says that it should once and for all be proved to this gentleman that while the words of Quran remain the same. So this is in response to somebody who criticized, right? Criticized that why are we performing these rituals and why are we following this and that. So it should once and for all be proved to this gentleman that while the words of the Quran remain the same every generation, every century, every period must have a new and different interpretation to that of the past. Otherwise, Islam will die and will not survive the competition of some healthy, less rigid competitors. So, and then I'll read on. He said, I'm standing here with a copy of the letter that one of the most eminent leaders of Islam in Pakistan, Mr. Amjad Ali, Council of Embassy, Charge of Affairs Minister in Washington, sent me. The substance of it should be read to this man to open his eyes, that the thinkers even in Pakistan realize that the rigidity of formal Islamic custom and religious ceremonies kills and has killed all Muslims and Muslim states and nations in the past. So he continuously, you know, portrayed Islam as very rigid and, you know, very, very, you know, restrictive. And he always promoted the, you know, living the, you know, Western values and the Western lifestyle, such as the example I gave a while back about very, very, you know, proudly speaking that, you know, I've made sure that there is no parda in my jamaat, and you would never find a Ismaili observing a parda. So that's how. So these are some of the, founding elements of Ismailism, which we've touched upon. I went off on a lot of tangents, but there are so many things behind each element that it's difficult to. I mean, this is like a full year course which I plan on running in the future, inshallah, when I compile everything on Ismailism. But it's difficult to, you know, keep it short. There are so many things to, you know, which remind me of other elements, such as the true lineage of Imams, or there was an Imam who became a Ismaili, or there was a disconnection between Ismailis when the Qiyamah was declared, and what the student Ismaili used to do. There are so many things, but in short, I think we've touched upon the basic Ismaili tenets and basically the Ismaili theology about the Dawr and the seven periods and the declaration of Qiyamah, and which ties in with the abolition of Sharia as the Ismaili see right now.
So one observation, then one question to you, Brother Akbar.
Sure.
You know, just looking at all the slides and what you have mentioned about their theology, it appears as if they are making a rules based on their convenience. You know, abrogation of the five prayers and the fasting and jihad and you know, zakat, the way that the Quran, the Sunnah says, it looks like it's a, you know, abrogation of convenience. Just like the Christians, yeah, they did away the rituals which are present in the Old Testament, and now they only go to church once a week. They don't fast, they don't do all of the, you know, praying. The Jews pray three times, they only pray one time. So they are following more spiritual aspect, a diluted version of what Isa alayhi salam and Musa alayhi salam brought to them. So it looks like Ismailis have done exactly the same thing, or almost similarly the same thing, right? That's my observation.
Yeah, absolutely. The height of, you know, realigning their religion to the materialistic world is that, you know, Christians, so in the Western world, the Sunday is a day off because Christians go to the church, right? In Ismailism, they've actually altered their prayer timings to suit the working hours. So this is another shocker. So what happens is that in the Western world, you know, you're living in Chicago, right? In the summer, Maghrib is what time? Like 9 p.m. in the night, somewhere around that time?
About 8:30-ish.
In Canada, like Maghrib goes up to like 9 p.m. in the night, right? Mm. And in summer, Maghrib is 4:30, 5 p.m. in the evening. Now, what happens is that now Ismailis in the in India and Africa and in Pakistan don't know this. But in North America, the jamatkhana timings for Ismailis are fixed at 7 p.m. and 7:30 p.m. So 7:30 p.m. on the working days, because, you know, you come late from work and so forth. You commute all the way to your home in the suburb. So 7:30 p.m. in the evening is the time for prayers. On the weekday, on the weekend it's 7 p.m. So it's convenience all year round. So regardless of the sunrise and the sunset timings, so Ismailis, even when they pray, they claim that this is their namaz. Their namaz has no connection to the sunrise and sunset. Because if it were, then who would really go to the jamatkhana at 9:30 in the night or at 5 p.m. in the winter, right? Nobody, right? So they fixed it at 7 and 7:30 p.m. And that's how the convenience, that's the extent to which the convenience has taken over the religious practices or the ahkam of the deen.
You know, for a Muslim, our life is supposed to revolve, our daily routine is supposed to revolve around the five daily prayers. But Absolutely. It looks like they are revolving the Quran and the Sunnah and the prayer around their convenience, around their life, around their
ritual. Around their lives. Yeah. Absolutely. So even their majalis, right, they would happen on Sundays, right? So just like the Christians would have their church on Sundays, Ismailis have their special majalis and special, you know, mandlis and member and these gatherings, to which they have to pay a membership fee, right? And then they become part of that majlis, and then the majlis gathering would happen either on a Sunday or some other day, depending again on convenience of when everybody's free to come.
So, Brother Akbar, a sensitive question about the Ismailis. You know, because they're not praying Fridays, abrogated the Sharia, equating or giving attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to a human being, on and on and on. What do the Muslim scholars say about them? Do they consider them as a sect of Islam or outside of Islam? Now, me and you, we're not here to say, you know, this person is a Muslim, this person is not. But what do the Muslim scholars say based upon what you showed and based upon the theology of the Ismailis?
The Muslim scholars, both Shia and Sunni, they are, I mean, I say that, you know, Shia and Sunni, they might not agree on much, but they definitely agree that the Ismailis are not in the fold of Islam, unfortunately, because of all of these things. I have several... decisions from the elite, the institutions of Islam. I have fatawa from the from Shia scholars as well, and actually the Shia scholars are more kind of offended by Ismailis, because Ismailis call themselves Shia.
Right.
So the Shia, they are more kind of offended by the Ismailis. The Sunnis, I see them, you know, the Sunnis are pretty, you know, they would even ask you that, like, what kind of question is that? You know, obviously Ismailis are not Muslim, but the reason is that because all of these abrogations which Ismailism has gone through, the fact that they don't practice any of the religious rituals, unfortunately that's what's led to these opinions, right? It's not, again, I tell Ismailis that it's not about you, it's about Ismailism, right? Ismailism is not part of Islam. You as a human being, you have a choice to come to Islam, right? If you just do your own evaluation, open up the Quran, see what the Quran says, see if your current practices align with the ahkam of the Quran, and if they don't, you know, then come to Islam. But the opinion of the scholars is not like finger pointing at each Ismaili and saying that, hey, you're not Muslim, you're not Muslim, you're not Muslim. It's about them saying that Ismailism, the Ismaili practices, if somebody follows those practices, then he doesn't belong to Islam.
You know, for Qadianis, if they identify as a Qadiani, then they cannot perform Hajj because they're not considered Muslim, so they cannot go for Hajj. What about the Ismailis? Do the Saudi government allow Ismailis to come and perform Hajj?
Ismailis, if some Ismaili wants to perform Hajj, yeah, surely he can, because Ismailis, they just identify themselves as Muslims. They don't, nowhere would any piece of ID, whether it's from India or Pakistan or anywhere, would show that they are Ismaili or they are Sheikh Imami or whatever. They would just say Muslim, right? Okay. So, but the thing is that Ismailis won't want to perform Hajj, because for them, Hajj, as I said, is looking at Aga Khan. That's their Hajj.
Yeah, it's quite shocking and alarming, you know, just to ponder on what you have said in the last hour or so. And I pray to Allah that may He protect all the Muslims and keep us guided on the right path, because it is so easy. If you admire some imam or some mufti or some scholar, some people, out of their ignorance and blind following, we just blindly may follow that person without questioning, without looking into the Quran and the Sunnah. So important advice for me, you and all the Muslims, all humans, is that education, the right education about Allah's guidance, who the Creator is, what purpose He has created us, what book He has sent as a guidance, the status of the messenger, how we should follow him. So those are the important bigger things in life that we need to ponder and we need to hold fast. If we don't, unfortunately, what we see here, imam after imam of theirs, Ismailis, deviating people, abrogating the rituals, and unfortunately leading towards the wrong path. So I hope and pray that may Allah protect all of us. And I want you to again mention your website, Brother Akbar. So those of our non-Muslim viewers and viewers from the Islamic, from the Ismaili faith, they can come there, they can educate themselves, they can ask you questions, inshallah, you are an expert in this. And with Allah's guidance, and I want to truly, truly have you, means the Ismaili brothers and sisters in humanity, pray for Allah's guidance. And Allah can guide and educate yourself through this website. So go ahead, Brother Akbar.
So yeah, just mentioning again, JazakAllah Khair, Sabeel, my website is www.rethinkingsmailism.com and www.insightsmailism.net. Right now, they are hosting somewhat different articles, but ultimately they would get merged into rethinkingsmailism.com. And then there's my YouTube channel called youtube.com/rethinkingsmailism, or just Rethinking Smailism on YouTube. So these are the two active platforms which are there right now. But on Facebook also, you can find the Rethinking Smailism page and the Smailism and Islam discussion group, which is again a group where people come and discuss Smailism. Again, Smailis are there, Muslims are there. They ask questions, they get answers. People ask for evidences. I'm usually there. Some members of my team are there to answer those questions for them.
And lastly, you know, so this was just one episode about the bigger picture of Ismaili theology. In the future episodes, I'm going to request Brother Akbar to come back again and to highlight like the five pillars of Islam. What are there from the Quran and the Sunnah? And what do the Ismailis believe or practice or not practice them? Or what is their belief regarding the pillars and other important aspects? So those future episodes, inshallah, we will continue. So departing words from you, Brother Akbar, what message that you would like to give to the viewers?
In the context of today's presentation, I know that many Ismailis, they don't have an insight into the Ismaili theology. So what I would call upon them to do is to go back to their sources and read what their real theology is and compare it with the Quran, because the Quran is the ultimate source of truth and guidance for all humanity. And that's what they should, you know, read, look into, read the translation and compare it to the, not only the Ismaili theology, which is also documented, but also with their practices, what they're doing. And pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a clean heart that, you know, oh Allah, guide me, you know, and guide me to the truth. And inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will inshallah show them the true path, inshallah.
All right. And also always, doesn't matter your pressure from your parents, your society, your jamatkhana, your imam, should not deter you from looking into Islam. Because on the day of judgment, no one can save you except alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So no imam, no parent, friends can come and save us on that day. So it's important that truth should matter to you and me the most. So we hope and pray that come and visit the website, Rethinking Ismailism and other social media platforms Brother Akbar has given. And we hope and pray that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us guided, help us to educate others with the knowledge and the honor Allah has given to us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can inshallah accept our efforts. And Jazakallah khair, Brother Akbar, mashallah, for a wonderful, eloquent packaging of Theology of Ismailism. And inshallah, we'll continue this in the next episodes.
Inshallah.
Jazakallah khair, and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.